Hi friends, this is Shridhi Joshi and today I am going to talk about wrist joint anatomy. Let's see wrist joint. So here this is proximal carpal row, this is distal carpal row. So wrist joint is made up of 8 small bone that is divided into 2 rows, proximal row and distal row. So that articulate with distal radius, ulnar and proximal metacarpals. The proximal row contains scaphoid, from lateral to medial it's scaphoid, lunate, triquetrium and pisiform. The distal row that contains trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. Just if you want to remember this carpal bones, so you can say that she looks too pretty, try to catch her. Okay. Arthrology of distal radio ulnar joint. The distal radio ulnar joint is formed between the head of ulna and ulnar notch on the lower aspect of radius. The type of joint is uniaxial pivotal joint. Ligaments dorsal and palmar radiocarpal radio ulnar ligaments and articular disc that is known as triangular fibrocartilage. This is triangular fibrocartilage, ulnar collateral ligament and radial collateral ligament. Let's learn biomechanics of distal radio ulnar joint. First, arthrokinematics. So in arthrokinematics, the concave surface is going to move on the convex surface. So here concave surface is ulnar notch of radius and convex surface is head of ulna. If we are doing supination, so that time radius roll and glide laterally over ulna. If we are doing pronation, so for that the radius that will glide and roll medially over ulna. Let's learn close peg, open peg position and capsular pattern for distal radio ulnar joint. Close peg position is 5 degree supination, open peg 10 degree supination. In capsular pattern, pronation and supination are equally limited. Let's learn about triangular fibrocartilage complex. So if we are learning triangular fibrocartilage complex, so for that here we can notice that it's a fibrocartilage disc that is interposed between medial proximal row of carpal bones and the distal ulna within the medial aspect of your wrist. The main function of this fibrocartilage is to enhance joint congruity and provide cushioning against the compressive force. Now we are going to see radiocarpal joint. The radiocarpal joint, that is biaxial ellipsoid joint, the concave surface of distal end of the radius and the proximal carpal row and triangular fibrocartilage that make radiocarpal joint. Here in this diagram we can notice that this is the proximal carpal row, here articular disc means triangular fibrocartilage and concave surface of distal end of the radius. Let's learn arthrokinematics motion of radiocarpal joint. So for that, this is radius, this is proximal carpal bone. So here convex surface is moving on concave surface. Here our concave surface is radius and the convex surface is proximal carpal. So if I'm doing flexion, so in this diagram we can notice that the flexion, so in flexion the proximal carpal roll anteriorly and glide posteriorly. Same way for extension. If we are checking for the extension in this diagram, we can notice that this is radius, this is proximal carpal bone. So proximal carpal roll posteriorly and glide anteriorly on radius. Let's learn about radial deviation and ulnar deviation, arthrokinematics of radiocarpal joint. So if we are doing radial deviation, in this diagram you can notice that the radial deviation is occurring. So for that, convex surface move on concave surface. Concave is your radius and convex is your proximal carpal lobe. So if I'm doing radial deviation, in radial deviation the proximal carpal is rolling, this proximal carpal that is rolling laterally and sliding medially on radius. And if we notice the ulnar deviation, so ulnar word, the proximal carpal bones that is rolling medially and sliding laterally on radius. Let's learn about intercarpal joint. So intercarpal joint, that is joint between the individual bones of the proximal row of the carpal bones. Individual joint of proximal row of your carpal bones. So ligament supporting our dorsal palmar and interosseous intercarpal ligament. Close peg position is neutral or slight flexion, and open peg position is neutral or slight flexion, and close peg position is extension. Let's see mid-carpal joint. That joint is compound articulation between proximal and distal row of carpal bone. In this we are not going to include PC form, so PC form is exception. Ligaments that supports this joint is dorsal and palmar ligaments. Open peg position or resting position is neutral or slight flexion with ulnar deviation. Close peg position extension with ulnar deviation. Capsular pattern, especially this is equally limited in flexion and extension. Let's learn arthrokinematics motion of carpometacarpal joint. So in that, concave surface move on convex surface for flexion and extension. This is flexion and this is extension. In this diagram we can notice that the concave surface is your trapezium and convex surface is your metacarpal. Now we are going to learn arthrokinematics motion of carpometacarpal joint and thumb. So for that, flexion and extension, concave surface move on convex surface for flexion and extension. So here this is for flexion and this is extension. So for that, concave surface is your trapezium, convex is your metacarpal. So for flexion, the metacarpal is rolling and gliding medially on trapezium, and here for extension the metacarpal that is roll and gliding laterally on trapezium. And for abduction and adduction, the convex surface that is moving on concave surface. So concave is your trapezium and convex is your metacarpal. So here the during abduction we can notice that the metacarpal is rolling proximally and gliding distal on trapezius. Same way for adduction, the metacarpal is rolling distally and gliding proximally on trapezium. Let's learn biomechanics of and arthrokinematics of metacarpophalangeal joint thumb and this metacarpophalangeal joint is 2 to 5. So for thumb, the concave surface that is moving on convex surface, the concave surface is base of proximal phalanx and the convex surface is head of metacarpal. So for flexion, this way flexion and the posterior way extension, if we are doing flexion, so distal phalanx roll and glide anteriorly on proximal phalanx, and for extension the distal phalanx roll and glide posteriorly on proximal phalanx. Let's see for MCP 2 to 5. So for that also concave surface that is moving on convex surface. So here the concave surface is base of proximal phalanx and convex is metacarpal head. So if we are doing flexion, so same way the proximal phalanx that is roll and glide anteriorly on metacarpal, and for extension the proximal phalanx roll and glide posteriorly on metacarpal. Let's learn arthrokinematics of interpharyngeal joint 2 to 5. So for that, concave move on the convex surface. The concave surface is base of proximal phalanx and convex is head of distal phalanx. So if we are doing flexion, so that time distal phalanx that roll and glide anteriorly on proximal phalanx, and for extension distal phalanx roll and glide posteriorly on proximal phalanx. Let's learn open back position, close back position and capsular pattern for different joints. First is radiocarpal or ulnar carpal joint. Open back position is neutral with slight ulnar deviation. Close back position is extension with radial deviation. Flexion and extension are equally limited in radiocarpal or ulnocarpal joint. For midcarpal, the open back position is neutral with slight flexion and ulnar deviation. Extension is close back position. Flexion and extension are equally limited in midcarpal joint. For CMC 2 to 5, open back position is midway between flexion and extension. Full opposition is close back position, and that is equally limited in all the directions. For trapezio-metacarpal joint, open back position is midway between flexion extension or midway between abduction and adduction. Full opposition is close back position. Abduction is more affected than extension. For MCP joints, first MCP slight flexion, and for second to fifth digit slight flexion and ulnar deviation is open back position. For close back position of first metacarpophalangeal joint is full extension. For second to fifth it's full flexion, and for capsular pattern is flexion is more affected than extension. For interphalangeal joint, proximal interphalangeal joint open back is 10 degree flexion, distal interphalangeal joint is 30 degree flexion, and full extension is their close back position, and flexion is first affected than extension in capsular pattern. Let's learn for range of motion of wrist joint. Flexion is 80 to 90 degree, extension 70 to 90 degree, ulnar deviation 30 to 45, radial deviation is 15. For MCP 2nd to 5th, flexion is 85 to 90 degree, extension is 30 to 45 degree. For proximal interphalangeal joint, flexion 100 to 115 degree and extension is 0 degree. For distal interphalangeal joint, flexion is 80 to 90 degree, extension is 20 degree. And for first carpometacarpal joint, flexion is 40 to 50 degree, abduction is 60 to 70 degree, adduction is 30 degree, and for a first MCP, flexion is 0 to 50 degree, and first interphalangeal joint flexion is 85 to 90 degree, extension is 0 to 5 degree. Now we are going to see flexors muscle. First is flexor carpi radialis. So for flexor carpi radialis, that is originated from medial epicondyle and coronoid process. It is inserted to the second and third metacarpal bases supplied by the median nerve. Main action is wrist flexion. Second is flexor carpi ulnaris. This is flexor carpi ulnaris muscle. So that is originated from the medial epicondyle and posterior ulna and inserted over the pisiform. Supplied by ulnar nerve. Main action is wrist flexion. Now we are going to see flexor digitorum superficialis. That is originated from medial epicondyle of humerus, coronoid process of ulna, and shaft of radius. In this diagram, we can notice that medial it is originated from the medial epicondyle of humerus, coronoid process of ulna, and shaft of radius. Inserted over the second to fifth phalanges, supplied by the median nerve. Main action is flexion of the wrist and fingers. Specially, it isolates the proximal interphalangeal joint flexion. Let's learn about palmaris, longest muscle, that is again originated from medial epicondyle of humerus, inserted to the palmar aponeurosis, supplied by median nerve, and main action is wrist flexion. Flexor digitorum profundus, so that is originated from coronoid process or anteromedial surface of ulna. And specially, it is inserted over the second to fifth distal phalanges. That is supplied by the ulnar medial aspect of the muscle, which flex the fourth and fifth digit, and the lateral aspect, which flex the second and third digit, is innervated by median nerve. This is innervated by ulnar. Main action is wrist and finger flexion. Flexor pollicis longus, originated from anterior surface of radius and inserted to the distal phalanx of the thumb, mainly supplied by the median nerve, and action is flexion of your thumb. Let's learn the extensor muscle. First is extensor carpi radialis longus, that is originated from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus and inserted to the second metacarpal base. If you can see the tendon, that is inserted to the second metacarpal base, and supplied by radial nerve. Main action is extension of your wrist. Now we are going to learn extensor carpi radialis brevis muscle, that is originated from lateral epicondyle of humerus, inserted to the third metacarpal base, and supplied by the radial nerve. Mainly it is wrist extensor and abductor of your wrist. Extensor carpi ulnaris muscle, that is originated from the lateral epicondyle and inserted to the fifth metacarpal, mainly supplied by radial nerve, extension and adduct your wrist. Extension digitorum, that is originated from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus and inserted to the second to fifth distal phalanges and supplied by the radial nerve. Extend the fingers is the action of extensor digitorum. Then we are going to learn extensor pollicis, that is originated from dorsal shaft of radius or ulna, inserted to the proximal or distal end of first phalanges and supplied by the radial nerve. Main action is extension of your thumb. Another muscle is extensor indicis. This is extensor indicis muscle, that is originated from the posterior surface of distal ulna and inserted to the second phalanges, supplied by the radial nerve, and main action is extension of your index finger. And the abductor pollicis longus muscle, that is originated from posterior surface of radius or ulna, inserted to the metacarpal, first metacarpal or trapezium of metacarpals, and supplied by the radial nerve. Mainly it extends the thumb and abduct your thumb. Wrist ulnar and radial deviators are for first ulnar deviators, flexicarpi ulnaris, extensicarpi ulnaris, and wrist radial deviators are extensor pollicis longus and brevis, extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis in the short form, and the flexor carpi ulnaris. Let's see muscle substitution. The wrist extensors, the most common substitution when fingers extensor are allowed to participate, so don't allow to extend their fingers. Long finger flexor, that is going to substitute for your lumbricar muscle, so avoid this pattern and make sure that interphalangeal joint is fully extended. The finger flexion of proximal interphalangeal joint, the flexor digitorum superficialis flex the proximal interphalangeal joint without flexing the distal interphalangeal joint. If muscle substitution is there, so the flexor digitorum profundus is a major substitution for flexor digitorum superficialis. So that will flex your proximal interphalanx, and patient is again going to flex the distal interphalangeal joint. Let's see for thumb flexion, metacarpophalangeal joint, flexor pollicis is longus. Long thumb flexors can substitute, but only after flexion of interphalangeal joints begins. So to avoid this substitution, don't allow the flexion of the distal joint of the thumb. Thumb extension, metacarpophalangeal joint, extensor pollicis is longus. The extension of interphalangeal joint of the thumb with carpometacarpal joint adduction and extension of metacarpophalangeal joint, that is indicate substitution by extensor pollicis longus muscle. Thumb abduction. So for thumb abduction, abductor pollicis longus and brevis, the extensor pollicis brevis can substitute for abductor pollicis longus muscle. If line of the pull is toward the dorsal surface of the forearm, extensor pollicis brevis, this substitution is occurring. Thumb adduction done by adductor pollicis, adduct the thumb, the flexor pollicis longus and brevis can substitute this adduction. Patient should adduct the thumb without flexing the MCP or IP to avoid substitution by thumb flexors. Let's learn active and passive insufficiency. For active insufficiency, muscle cannot shorten more. For passive insufficiency, the muscle cannot stretch more. So for wrist flexors, active insufficiency is elbow flexion and wrist flexion. Here in this, we can notice that muscle cannot shorten more than this position. Passive insufficiency, elbow extension and wrist extension. So muscle cannot stretch more. For wrist extensors, active insufficiency is elbow flexion and wrist extension. Here elbow is flexed maximally shortened position and wrist is in extension position. So beyond this, muscle cannot shorten more. And for passive insufficiency, elbow extension and wrist flexion. So muscle cannot stretch more in this position. For tenoresis, wrist flexion with hand opens. In this diagram, we can notice that if patient is doing wrist flexion, so your hand is going to open. Why? Because your wrist flexors are activate to maintain the length of extrinsic finger extensors. So that's why with wrist flexion, hands open, and with wrist extension, hands tries to close, because wrist extensors are activate to maintain the length of extrinsic finger flexors. Let's learn something about anatomical snuff box. So what is anatomical snuff box? That is the depression on the posterior, or this is your posterior or dorsal surface of the hand at the base of thumb and distal to the radius. The anatomical snuff box that is formed by abductor pollicis longus muscle, extensor pollicis brevis muscle here, and while the ulnar border that is formed by tendon of extensor pollicis longus muscle. This is observed during active radial abduction of the thumb. Let's learn functional position of hand and wrist. Wrist is in 20 to 30 degree extension, slightly ulnar deviation. Finger are in 45 degree of metacarpophalangeal joint and 15 degree of proximal interphalangeal joint and distal interphalangeal joint flexion. And thumb should be abduction in 45 degree. The great amount of grip is available in this position. This is your functional position of your hand. The immobilization position of your wrist. Wrist is in 30 degree extension, slight ulnar deviation, with MCP joints are more flexed and IP joints are extended. So it is positioned like the thumb and the pulp of finger come in contact together. That is your immobilization position of your wrist. The functional position and immobilization position is very helpful while immobilization, and after that we are going to return for our functional phases. So for that we need functional position of our hand for day-to-day activities. Now we are going to learn about different grips. Grip is divided into two parts. First is power grip, second is precision grip. Power grip, that is again divided into cylindrical, hook, spherical and fist. And the precision or prehension, that is divided into pulp to pulp, lateral, tip to tip and three jaw chuck. First we are going to see power grip, that is used for force stabilization of an object with hand. Mostly use the ulnar side of your hand. This grip is cylindrical grip, in that the palmar surface of your hand is used to grasp the hand around the object. For example, this person has hold the hammer in his hand or the baseball grasp. Muscle used are finger flexors, thumb abductors and intrinsic muscles of your hand. The spherical grip, that is you can notice in this picture, the cup, this is the cup, the thinner and hypothinner eminence to the object with different degrees of finger flexion. For example, grasping this ball. The hook grasp, in this diagram we can notice that a lady is carrying the basket of some clothes, and that is with her finger, so that is hooked. This is hook around her finger. So hook is formed by finger flexors, and that muscle is flexor digitorum profundus is involved here. For example, the suitcase holding or for the bag holding. Power grip, or in that fist grip, the grasp that hold around a narrow object. So in this the person has holded something narrowly on the fist, so that is known as fist grasp. Then precision or prehension grip. The muscle primarily function to provide exact control of finger and thumb position. That is known as precision or prehension grip. In that, first we are going to see tip to tip grip. So this is the tip of thumb, this is the tip of index finger, and the person has holded the pin, safety pin she has holded in her hand. So tip of thumb opposed against the tip of other digit, that is known as tip to tip grasp. Let's see lateral pinch. In lateral pinch, the thumb pad against the lateral aspect of your index finger. For example, pencil holding or key holding. Muscle used are adductor pollicis longus and first introsai. The pulp to pulp prehension. In pulp to pulp prehension, the pad of thumb and the opposition of your index finger or other finger we use for pulp to pulp grip. For example, if we take the pinch of salt. Let's see two or three jaw chuck in prehension. So for that we have to use index finger, thumb and middle finger. For example, if we are sprinkling some herbs with the help of multi-finger pinch, that is known as two or three jaw chuck grasp.
Thanks for watching, and for future videos don't forget to subscribe. If you have any doubts related to topics in physical therapy exams, please let me know in my comment section so I can make a series of the videos on that. Till that time, stay positive. Bye-bye.